Good evening. If you will, open your Bibles to Luke chapter 15. That's going to be our text for this evening's lesson. As we talk about prodigal surprises, when you look at Luke chapter 15, and our text is going to be taken from Luke 15, verse 11 through 32, and this is going to be part one of this lesson, and next Sunday night we will conclude this lesson. This is going to be a two-part lesson. When we look at this particular text, there's so much that can be gleaned from it. I'd like for us first to read it, and then I would like for us to talk about the text itself. And so what we're going to do is begin in Luke chapter 15. We're going to begin in verse 11, and we're going to read down to verse 32. And he said, "A certain man had two sons. The younger of them said unto his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land. And he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat. No man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said unto his servants, Bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry, for this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, Thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry, and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answering said to his father, Lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which has devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. When we read this text and you see the full context of what is taking place with the publicans and sinners and the scribes, that are accusing Jesus in the context, the first part of Luke chapter 15. This man eats or receives sinners and eats with them. And he starts off with the parable of the lost sheep. He deals with the lost coin. And then he comes to the text that we have for our text tonight, and that is the lost son. And you see, we're going to draw 6 points from this, 3 we're going to look at tonight, and 3 next Sunday night, as we consider this passage that we have read. When you look at the passage, you will notice that you've got a great contrast that goes on, especially here from verse 11 all the way down. And that contrast is between this beautiful picture that exists of a father who is compassionate, who is loving, who is forgiving, and willing to receive back a son that has wandered away and then returned home. And there's that beautiful picture that's there. And you have that contrast that is laid against that of his older brother, the eldest son, who is bitter, who is harsh, who is angry, who was upset at the situation. Instead of rejoicing and being excited and being happy that his brother has come back and returned, he's not happy about the situation at all. And so you see this huge contrast that exists even in the text as this is laid out, and certainly it directly has an impact upon the Pharisees, the scribes, and those that were there that had a problem with Jesus trying to reach those that were lost and to bring them home. And really it goes back to the context of the first 2 verses that are found in Luke chapter 15 and the context that is there. And so there you've got that context. You've got some that would rejoice at a sinner that would return and others that would not, that would have a problem with the situation. But we see this huge the contrast that is here. And we think about the surprises that, as we will draw 6 of those surprises from the prodigal, we think of surprises that maybe one day we will have. And, you know, what about when we get there in eternity, or maybe we're there on the judgment day and we look around and maybe there are those that we thought would be there and they're not there. Or maybe those that we thought would not be there, and they are there. You know, there will be surprises for us all, and I'm sure at some point in life we have had certain surprises, but there are surprises that I want to talk about regarding the prodigal, and we will look at 6 of those. The first 3 are this. His father allowed him freedom. Number 2, it's easy to leave. And number 3, we'll see the depth of sin. The very first thing that I want us to look at is that his father gave him his portion, allowed him to leave. And you'll have to pardon my typo, because him is him. I guess I was trying to make it real southern. You know, with the pig and the slop, it makes sense. So, his father gave him his portion. And he sure did. And so, you know, at some point in life, as you grow up, you know, you get to a point where you want to leave home, where you're ready to be able to move out and to go out on your own. And that can be challenging for parents. It can be challenging for children in both of those scenarios. And so here's a young man who's ready. He's ready to what we would say is he's ready to get out of Dodge. He wants to get away. He wants to grow up. He wants to live his own life. And there's certain aspects of that are commendable. Don't we want our young people to grow up and leave the home? We don't want them to leech on us forever, for eternity. We'd like for them to grow up and to become an individual that they can be, and to have certain things that are their own. And so there's a certain aspect of this story that is beneficial, of this parable, where we're looking at this young man who wants to leave. He wants to go out and to make his own life. And we say, well, you know, that's great. That's a good thing. Unfortunately, the direction that he chose was not a good thing. And so many times we have individuals that want to go out and they want to say, okay, I want my portion. I want to leave. I want to go make my start. And what we see in this instance is, we've got a young man who's at that point, and he starts thinking about his situation. He starts thinking, well, you know, I'll get my inheritance when my father dies. But boy, you know, that could be a while. There could be some time that has to pass, and what if I have to wait to get my inheritance, and then I'll be old, and then I won't be able to go out and to do those things that I have in my mind to do while I have youth and vitality and all of the, you know, this passion and this drive. And so the young man says, you know, give me my inheritance. I'd like to have it now, and I'm going to go. Some people might look at that, and you know, there's a couple of different ways to look at that, but certainly there could be a positive aspect, at least, for this young man who says, you know, I think I'd like to go ahead and go make a try, go make a go of this now. And so he says, give it to me. I'm not sure if that young man really thought that he would get it. I mean, in most scenarios where somebody comes and says, now, I want my inheritance now. And you're like, well, you know, I have a will, I've made it out for you, and you will get that when I die. No, I want it now. And I don't know how many of us would say, okay. But in this parable, we have the father who was willing to give him his portion and allow him. He granted his request. I think that was probably a surprise. The young man goes to his father, give it to me now. The father says, in my mind, I'm thinking probably the father would have tried to talk him out of it, would have tried to reason with him and try to get him to be patient and to not, because he probably assumed if he gave him the lump sum of everything that was going to be his, with youth, he would go and waste it all in one big lump. I mean, that's what happens a lot of times when people think, I'm going to be rich for the rest of my life when I win the lottery. They win the lottery, and a year goes by, and they're broke. Why? They spent it all. And they don't have anything else, and they thought, oh, if I just get this, then I'm going to have all of this the rest of my life. And so you've got this young man, he gets all of this together, and the father grants the request. You say, well, how does this apply to us spiritually speaking? When we tell God and we make up in our mind, you know, this is what I'm going to do. When we set out our heart and our mind to do a certain thing and we decide, this is what I'm going to do, God's going to say, okay. He's going to allow us to do it. He's going to give us the freedom to do it. He's not going to say, absolutely not. I will not allow you to decide to go over here and serve Satan. I will not allow you to go over here and live in riotous living or in sin or in wickedness or in... I won't do it. No. The Father allows it. He grants it. Because if He didn't, He would be taking away freedom. He would be taking away free will. And so God grants free will to the individual. He allows then him to go, and we can see that even in this text. God will say, okay, here is your life. Here is your opportunity to make good with your life, to either glorify me or not. And I give you the opportunity to glorify me. I give you the opportunity to serve me. But many times, people do not choose that path. Unfortunately for this young man, he did not choose that path. And so that's one surprise. I mean, his father gave him his portion. I mean, he's got everything he was going to have. He didn't have to wait for it. And now he goes off to the far country. And he's going to spend it. What we also notice is this is a surprise, at least to this young man, as it is many people today. He was surprised at how easily he could just leave. It was easy for him to leave home. It was easy for him to go into a far country. And so when we look at the text, the far country implies not just that he went a distance away from home. A person does not have to go far from home to live in wickedness and sin and rebellion to God. He can go next door. You know, he doesn't even have to leave the home to do that and to live in sin. So it just implies that he went to this far country, he's going far away from the Father. And when we look at that from a spiritual perspective, we're saying he went far away from the Heavenly Father. And the idea is he went far into wickedness and sin and rebellion against God, it's an easy thing for an individual to drift away from the faith. It's not actually that hard. It's actually quite easy to do. So many drift into a far country of unfaithfulness. They have a lack of steadfastness, and so they begin to drift away, and lo and behold, they wake up and they are in a far country and they are far from the Father. How many of you have ever been fishing out on a boat? A lot of us have been fishing. But how many of us have gone out in a boat and gone fishing? I noticed we've had recently a family that's been fishing, and it was posted for everybody to see. And they could probably tell you exactly about what I'm about to describe. You've gone out into a boat to fish. You say, this spot looks good. It's where we're going to fish. So you pull up to that spot, and you start fishing. And you're not paying attention because you're fishing. You're working that lure, and then another cast, you're working it. And lo and behold, after a while, you realize, wait a minute, we drifted about 15, 20 feet. We're not even where we were trying to get over there. And that's where we know the fish are. We maybe even marked them with our fish finder. We know they're over there, but now we're not there anymore. What's happened? We drifted. And really, unconsciously, we didn't really intend on that happening, but we drifted. That happens frequently, especially when fishing in a boat, and you know that. And that also happens to members of the body of Jesus Christ. They begin to drift, maybe unconsciously, and slowly, and drifting into indifference. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever seen a member of the church in all your many years of service to God? Have you ever seen a member of the church come forward before a congregation and make an announcement to the congregation like this? You know, I've been faithful for many years. I've always been here, Sunday night, Sunday morning. I've always been here for Wednesday night, but you know, this Sunday night at 5 p.m., I've got other plans. So I don't intend to be at service any longer. And by the way, I know that the same thing is, you know, Wednesday night, I've always been here and I've been a part of the Bible class and I've been studying the Bible every Wednesday night as far as I can remember. You know, when the doors are open, that's where I have been, but I've got better things to do, and I won't be back. I just wanted to let the congregation know that. And, you know, as far as visiting the sick or going to see the hospital or being involved in the work of the church, you know, I've been involved, very involved, but I'm done. I ain't doing that anymore. How many of you ever heard an announcement like that? Well, I don't know about you, but I've never heard that. I've never heard anybody come forward and say, you know what? I'm done. I've been faithful, but I'm leaving. Bye. You know why? Because it doesn't generally happen that way. It begins slowly. They begin to drift off, and then you start seeing that they're not there on Wednesday nights, and then it just happens over a period of time. Maybe for many years, they're very faithful, and they're there all the time, and then all of a sudden, slowly, you start missing them, and then they're not there anymore on Wednesday night, Sunday night, and then they're just not there at all. They didn't come before the congregation and saying, I need to make an announcement. I'm leaving. But what had they done? They've drifted away. They've dropped off of activity and of service. How'd they get that way? Same way the prodigal got into a far country. After he got there, he looks back upon where he is. He notices where he is. He looks back where he came from. And I'm sure he never realized it was going to be that easy to just go so far away from the Father and for his life to look so very different than what it was before. One of the easiest things to do is to drift away from faithfulness to God. You know, you don't even have to exert any energy. You don't even have to pray. You don't even have to think. It's that easy. What happens sometimes when people move into a new place? I mean, you know, they move. Maybe they were members at a congregation. They move and to a new place. Nobody knows them, and they never darken the doors. Why is that? Again, it's easy to drift. It's easy to just decide, well, you know, I'm going to do that. I'm going to find a congregation. I'm going to find a place where I will. And then before long, you attend the Box Springs Church of Christ. That means you never get up off your mattress. You sleep. There's no Box Springs Church of Christ. I see some faces that you've never heard that expression before, but that's just an old country expression we used to say that means you're not worshiping anywhere, you're just sleeping in. Yeah. You're not faithful at all. You're not worshiping God at all. You've wandered, you've drifted, and it didn't really take any effort. That's why some will come Lord's Day morning. In the morning, they'll eat the Lord's Supper. They'll forget about living for Christ during the week until the next Lord's Day, and then they'll just do the same again. Sadly, the prodigal never did come to his senses until he had literally sunk into the mire, sunk into sin very deeply. He didn't come into his senses until he got to the bottom of the barrel. It never really dawned on him that he was drifting away from his home, from his father, and into sin like he did until he finally came to his senses and looked around and considered where he was, what he had been involved in, how he had been living, and the choices that he had been making. This is the way that people drift away from the church. They drift away from God today. And so when you look at this parable, you see that the Father is God the Father, the Son, represented, if we're looking at this parable and application to us as a Christian, and that people can drift away from the ark of safety, they can drift away from the kingdom, they can drift away from the church. So sometimes you have what we would consider a traditional church member. How much do they promote the kingdom of God, that traditional church member? And what I mean by that is they may come and eat the Lord's Supper on Sunday morning. That's it. For example, you can do this as a practice if you want, or you can just do this in your mind. Just imagine if you're going to write down on a piece of paper, and if you don't have a piece of paper and pen, you don't want to physically write this down, then you can do that in your mind. Write down this. On Sunday morning, I go to worship, I eat the Lord's Supper, I go home. So on Sunday morning, I go to worship, I eat the Lord's Supper, I go home. And then the question is, what else do you do? You've already written that down. Now it's time to write, what else do I do? What else do you do? And so you have to fill that in for yourself. No one else can do that for you. And so you're looking at your Christian walk. What else do I do for Christ? Begin to fill that list. If you've got nothing, there's nothing else that you can put there, then that gives you an idea of your spiritual standing, just how you actually are living each and every day for Christ. How are you working for Him in His kingdom? You know, when going around and talking to different people through the years that have fallen away, and when trying to restore them and to work with them to bring them back home, frequently when you sit down with someone who has been living just as this gentleman had been, this young man, and you sit down with them, they will tell you, it will come from their lips, they will say, I never realized, I never dreamed I would get to this place. I would have never dreamed that I would have ever allowed myself to drift off to where I am today. But I was there before I knew it, before I even realized it. You know, when we go to Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1, it says, therefore we must give the more earnest heed to the things we have heard, lest we drift away. That's the New King James Version. Lest we drift away. A surprise? It was easy. It was easy to leave. It's just as easy to leave the Lord and be unfaithful unto Him, and so we need to be aware of that. Another surprise is just the depth of sin that exists. I'm sure this young man in the beginning thought, man, the sky's the limit, you know? Now, here he is, I mean, he's ready to start his life. He's going to get out from underneath his folks, right? And he's got a wherewithal now because he got his inheritance. So he's got something to do. He's got dreams and hopes. He's got an aim. And he's going to go make the world great. He's going to do something great. And then this young man goes away from home and begins to make poor choices. One after the other, after the other, after the other. And the Bible says he spent all of his money with riotous living. Luxurious living. Squandered it with the prodigal, wasteful living. And you know, when he had money, then there's friends that are everywhere. When people have money, somebody wins the lottery, buddy, you may not have heard from anybody that you knew of, but if you get it big, you strike it rich, or for whatever reason somebody finds out, you come into the money, and then boy, you got friends you never knew you had. And there they are, they want to talk, and they're there for you because of the money. And in the same way, you know, I'm sure he had all the friends in the world that were there while he had until he spent it all. And that's why it says he was shocked. There's nobody there. Nobody there to help him. And he realized he was on his own. No money. He's on his own. And all he's got is the depth of sin he's put himself in. How he got there. Because he had to sit and think, you know, I'm sitting in this pen. I'm looking at that pig food. And you know what? I'm hungry. And it looks pretty good at this point. You know, that's pretty bad. I mean, that is low to sit with the pigs and say their food is looking real good. I don't know that I've ever done that, but he did. And he begins to think, you know, how did I get here? How did I get here? And then I'm sure everything that led him to this point then went back in reverse order, and he began to replay exactly how he got there. That's what it means to come to your senses. And he starts to replay exactly how he got there, and he thinks about all the riotous living that he's lived, and prodigal living, and wasteful living, and squandering, and living in sin, as his elder brother would suggest with the harlots, and doing all of these things that he has done. And then it led him back to where he was before all of that to his father. He probably would have never believed, even if somebody had told him before he left, this is where you could end up. If you make these bad choices in your life, this is where you could end up. He probably would have never believed it. Even if somebody had told him that, he wouldn't have believed it. But guess where he is? Looking at pig food, thinking, that looks good. That looks, I'm hungry. I think I'll eat that. You know, you think about a new Christian who's faithful, filled with excitement. And then they start missing. Things get a little rocky. Start losing them for different services. And then all of a sudden, you see them no more. They become unfaithful. And maybe you hear that now they are living much, much worse than even when they started. The Bible talks about sin and how awful it is to go back to it. And Peter talks about that. It's like a pig going back to wallow in the mire. You take a pig and, you know, some of these 4-H contests and different things like that in the fairgrounds. Boy, they make those pigs look so nice, but it takes a lot of work, especially try to get them there, because even if you get them there, they may want to wallow around more in some more mire, or they want to get dirty. So they gotta bathe them, and they try to make them smell good, and they try to. But you know what? The Bible gives a picture of an individual that wants to go back to sin. And that picture is, it's like a pig that wants to go back and wallow in the mire after they've been clean. God wants us to remain clean and cleansed and pure. And yet when we want to go back to sin, it's like a pig that wants to go back and wallow in their own poop and mud. It's gross.
That's what they would prefer that. They would like to wallow around in it and be covered in it like the picture that's illustrated here. It's like a dog that wants to go back to what they've spit out of their mouth and eat it again. It's gross. That's the picture of sin, is what is described in the Bible, and the depths of sin. It's hard to get people to see that when they begin to drift a little and they continue in that path, ultimately they'll wind up in the ditch and in the depths of sin. What we learned from this? Surprises the prodigal would have had. Well, the father allowed him to have freedom. Your heavenly father is not going to force you to obey him. He's not going to force you to choose to do what's right. He's not going to force you to love him and serve him. He will allow you to choose what path you will go down. Secondly, when you choose to live for him, to obey him, to become a New Testament Christian, and to surrender, just as easy as it was to obey the gospel, it's just as easy to leave. And so we have to be aware of that so that we do not drift away from our service and our faithfulness unto God, because it is easy to allow ourselves to slowly drift away to where we wake up and we're in a far country, we don't even know how we got there. Do we wake up and we're not faithful, we've not been doing what we know we should be doing, and we wonder, how did we get there? How did we get here? Number three, the depths of sin. The devil promises big things. He always does. Promises big, but he never delivers. Never. And so we always end up with heartache. We think, oh, this is going to be good, this is going to be great. What kind of pleasure, what kind of joy, what kind of good is going to come out of this for me? And the devil always promises these good things, and then we start looking at the consequences and what comes out of it and the heartache that sin will bring. The depths of sin. Satan always promises something great and glorious, but what he will deliver in the end is weeping and gnashing of teeth. Tonight, if you're not a Christian, won't you give your life to the Father who loves you, who will welcome you, who gives you the freedom to choose to serve Him? Will you believe that His Son, Jesus, is the divine Messiah, the Christ, the chosen one of God, the Savior of the world? Will you believe that He is the resurrected one? Will you believe that and confess that with your lips? Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10. With the heart, man believeth unto righteousness. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Romans chapter 10 and verse 10. You can do that tonight. Will you turn away from your past rebellion? That's repentance. For this man, he was already in that mire. He came to his senses, and what did he have to do when he was down in that mire looking at the pig feed? What did he have to do to get back to his father? He had to turn around and walk back. When a person decides they're going to live a life of sin and rebellion unto God, they've separated and departed from God, they have to turn around and say, I want to go back to the Father. That's repentance. It's a change of mind, a change of heart that results in a change of action. And the Bible calls all men everywhere to repent, Acts 17 and verse 30. Will you then be baptized? Acts 2 and verse 38 says, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. You can do that today, so that the Lord then will forgive you of your sins. That's what remission of sins describes. That's forgiveness. In Acts chapter 22 and verse 16, it says, why are you waiting? Arise, be baptized, and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Tonight you can do that. Or it may be that you have learned the hard way. It's easy to leave. And you've departed from the path of right, as 1 John chapter 1 teaches, that we are to walk in the light so that the blood of Jesus can continually cleanse us. And maybe we've departed from that. We're not living there. We need to come home. You can come home tonight to the Heavenly Father. We'd be happy to help you in any way that we can. If you have a need, won't you come as together we stand and as we sing.